fear, depression, anxiety? Are you having problems with your children, or have you problems with your spouse, or have you gone through a recent divorce? Are you having problems in your ministry, what we call church hurt? Welcome to the ER. I'm your host, Reverend Ed Schaefer, First Baptist Church of Robbinsville, and we have a show for you.
There's an army rising up, yeah, to break every chain, break every chain.
Welcome back. Welcome back to the ER. First, let me introduce you to the awesome ER crew. And we are ready for spiritual emergencies. Let me tell you the phone number first. 609-807-2492. Dial in. 609-807-2492. Let me introduce you to our awesome cast. To my left, your right, we have the awesome Sister Cheryl Schaefer, First Lady of First Baptist Church of Robbinsville.
Yay.
I'm glad to be here on the panel today.
Awesome. And to my far right, your left, on Facebook and on YouTube, you have the awesome one and only Reverend. She's going to talk about Dr. Jesus a little later. Reverend Doris Warner.
I am so glad to be here today.
Awesome. Here we go. Drum rolls. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to the one and only, to the R and the ER, to my brother and my brother. The right reverend. Why you call him right? Because he do what's right. Oh. Reverend Rob Cleveland.
Amen.
Yay.
Looking forward to a good show.
Awesome. And of course, you know, we have our awesome minister. And you may be hearing from her a little later on. Our walk-in caller, Minister Saluna Cleveland.
Yay.
And she's giving me the nod, like, Rev?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. I know that we have a show, an awesome show today. Who do we have here?
Well, today we have with us Brother Chris Dannis from Lumberton, New Jersey. Welcome.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Glad to be here.
Amen. Well, you know how we do on the ER. This is about testimonies.
That's right.
It's about talking about how God has saved you, how God has redeemed you, pretty much how God has loved you. And we know that Chris has a testimony. He has an awesome word for us, so let's jump right into it.
Awesome.
All right, thank you. I appreciate that. I feel very comfortable, very welcome. I appreciate that, everybody.
Awesome.
Chris, you'll start in telling us a little bit about you. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm a 33-year-old man. I hail from Camden, New Jersey. Not currently, but that's where I grew up. Spent most of my time. I've got a beautiful 8-year-old daughter. Love her to death. And I'm just your average Joe, I guess you could say, pretty much. And trying to think of a good place to start. And I guess I can start my earlier years and just fast forward up a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I was a kid. You don't really have time. Well, I didn't really have time for religion as a kid. You know, they tried to get me into it. They sent me to after school class, you know, and it was always just a placeholder, I guess, you know, something I had to do before I could run out the door and go have some fun. So I kind of just really ignored it for the most part growing up, and which I didn't really see as a problem. And, you know, into my teenage years, I started diving into the drugs and all that jazz, and it really, I wouldn't even say it was that big of a problem then. It was a problem, but right, not something that would give me any hiccups, I guess you could say. You know, mm-hmm. I was still doing school. I was still getting good grades. So I didn't see it as a problem.
Okay.
And it wasn't until later on after I graduated that things started getting rough. I started moving around. I started moving to different relatives' house, sleeping on the couch, getting crappy jobs, still doing the drug thing. And then I moved down the shore, and I was still doing the drug thing, you know. And I got a job. Still doing the same old stuff. And, you know, God really never entered my mind. And I guess in that time, I didn't not believe in God, but I didn't fully believe in God at that time. You know, I was a little bit on the fence, and I guess I needed that little push, and that didn't come till a little bit later. And, you know, I enjoyed doing those drugs. And at this time I'm doing like everything under the sun, like anything you can think of, I did it. And eventually it doesn't become, it's not a fun thing anymore. You're doing it so you're not sick anymore. Come you know, on. So you can go to work the next day and not be in pain. So it really became a chore. It's something you had to have to keep going the next day. And it gets very tiresome because at the end of the night, you're hoping, please let me find something for the next day so I can go to work. You know, please let me find. That's very exhausting. That's very exhausting. And I'd say I went through this for about a good 5 years until I got tired of it. And I tried to get some help, you know. They have doctors out there for that sort of stuff, and that didn't really do much. It didn't really do much. So I started praying, and even at that time, I still wasn't fully convinced. I was still on the fence, but I figured, hey, why not, right? So I started praying, and it's funny because what happened that turned everything around, I really didn't look at it at like a blessing at first. It was a nightmare, I'd say, for the first little bit. I found out that my girlfriend had become pregnant. And, you know, I'm, 25 at the time. You know, I live with my grandmother. I'm on all these drugs. I run out of money within a week of getting paid. And I'm like, what am I going to do? You know, that's not really an answer to my prayer, right? But it was. It actually was. And it changed my life with like the snap of a finger. It was crazy. And, you know, the word abortion started getting thrown around. And we kind of just planted our feet and said, let's see what we can do. Let's see what we can do. And literally overnight, we just stopped everything. And that was 8.5 years ago. And I haven't done anything since.
Wow, amazing.
And you know, started praying more, started reading the Bible more,
come on,
started doing my research, you know, and I haven't stopped since. So it was crazy. I mean, it's a very drastic switch, you know, going from one extreme to the other. It was an experience.
Wow.
How did you get introduced to
drugs? I friends on a corner, you know, smoking a little bit of weed at first. And it's always starts with the minor stuff first.
Right.
And, you know, I know people say, you know, weed's not a gateway drug. People got to – any drug is a gateway drug, right. All right? Because you're always thinking about, well, this feels good, and it's not really doing me any harm. I wonder what the next thing feels like. What the next thing feels like. And you just get real curious. And when you hit that next thing, sometimes you're going to get stuck. And that's exactly what happened to me. So.
Wow, that right there, on that point, that's such an important thing to know. And important to really stress out, because I have a young man here saying that, listen, any drug is a gateway drug, mm-hmm. because the curiosity, if I can handle this, I'm ready to take it to another level. And it don't matter where you live and what country you're in, this is an important note.
Mm-hmm.
This is important. Thank you.
Not a problem. Yeah, and that's stuff is very hard to come off of. I know some people think, you know, I can do it. I'll do it for a little bit. And I'll come off, you know, I'll stop doing it when I feel like it. But like I said, when your body gets physically addicted to that stuff, you don't have a choice at that point. You know, you're either going to do it so you're not sick, or you're going to be in excruciating pain. And I mean pain, like, I mean, there were days where it felt like my legs were on fire. And you know, I was doing everything I could just to get out of bed and use the bathroom. It was so bad, you know, and you'll do anything to get that pain to go away.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So, it's an experience.
Wow.
Now, would you say that your experiences has caused your faith to grow, and that where you came from, you really don't want to go back? So you know, I know a lot of times we say, well, you know, I believe in God, and people sort of like call themselves dabbling in God. But if you get hit hard enough from the devil,
that's right,
you'll want to jump, you know, all in with God. Would you say that was your experience?
Yes, yes, 100%. And if the devil exists, then God must exist too, right? Yes, I would have to agree with that statement. And another thing I wanted to touch on, you know, when you're a kid and you're growing up and you're going through school and they have the DARE program and they tell you, you know, don't do drugs, just say no. But they never really tell you why.
Oh, wow.
You know, they just say these are bad, don't do them. And when you're a rebellious teenager, you're going to do what you want no matter who says what, mm-hmm. you know, unless you get some in-depth detail of why I shouldn't be doing this. And I'm glad that I went through that experience. It was painful, you know, it ruined me a few times. But now instead of my daughter hearing, oh, well, you shouldn't do these drugs just because, I can give her those experiences and those details.
Wow.
As to, if you do drugs, this is what's going to happen.
Wow.
And I think it's important that if you're going to teach kids why that drugs are bad, you need to explain to them why and the repercussions. And it's not just, oh, you're not going to have any money or people aren't going to like you. You know, there is physical repercussions to that and lifelong repercussions to that. And they need to explain that to you a little better, I think. So I'm thankful that I went through those hard times, because now mm-hmm. I can pass it on to my daughter.
Absolutely. And you just said something real important, lifelong repercussions.
Yes.
You know, because there are things that physically that happens to you, mm-hmm. as well as financially that happens to you, that can ruin you, especially dealing with that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you brought up the DARE program, and I love what you just said. You said, listen, it's better to just say, don't do it, but educate. Right. Educate our matter of fact, not just our kids, let's right. educate our community.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Our society mm-hmm. on this is the effects of drugs.
That's right.
You know, yes, that's so important.
I think that, yeah, that should be something that's done more regularly, you know, not just a don't do this. And I think everybody should see, because, you know, you're right. There are grown folk that never really understood why drugs are, you know, are bad or, mm-hmm. or what the repercussions of them should be.
That's right.
And, yeah, I think everybody could take something out of a more detailed program. I mean, it might be different now. You know, I haven't seen a drug-free program since I was in high school. So they may have upped their game a little bit. But my experiences, you know, it was just don't do this. And mm-hmm. that wasn't enough to, all right, you know, stop me in my tracks and not try. And but yeah. if a kid's parents are saying don't do them, you know, and they might not have the same experiences, you know, you can talk to me and I'll give you all the experience you need.
And I like the fact that your daughter is here in the studio.
Oh, yeah.
And you weren't ashamed to bring her and to talk about these things, because a lot of times as parents will go through things in our past and we may not even talk about them with our kids, but his daughter is right here listening to this testimony, and she's 8 years old, so the earlier the better.
Yep. Oh, I've had conversations with her, and I'm not sure if she understands it fully yet, but, you know, since she could talk, you know, I've told her, you know, when you get older, we're going to sit down, and I got some things to tell you. And, I, you know, I've tried to tell her now, and I think to her right now it's just information that she doesn't truly mm-hmm. understand yet.
Right.
But, no, she's going to know every little tidbit of information I got for her, so she's more prepared when she gets older and someone tries to hand something to her.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm. And that's a blessing. Ooh. You know, because so many stories get passed down to a child about their parents after the parent has gone through something so bad that mm-hmm. a lot of times they've passed away, and now that we got to tell these past tense stories mm-hmm. about what my dad used to be.
Yeah.
You know, I remember your dad, he was a good man. I remember your mom, she was a good woman, but they're gone. So when God gives you an opportunity to be here and to be in the presence of your child, you have to take that opportunity. You can't shield them, you know, because you don't want them to go through. And you want to thank God that you had an opportunity to be there with them, to give the stories to them. You know, you said that you, when people want to talk to you, that you, you know, you're ready to give them the real about drugs.
Awesome.
You know, if a person was to walk in this room right now, you can clear, we can clearly tell that they're hooked on some type of drug. You know, what would you say to them concerning Jesus Christ and what he's done for you to get the light to come on? You know, to those of us that have never been hooked on drugs, I really don't know what to say to someone like that.
Well, I would say that he'll give you the, it's not, and I don't want this to sound the wrong way. It's you can't put it all on God, right?
That's
he'll
right.
give you an opportunity, right. and you have to want to take that opportunity.
Right.
And I would tell them that, you know, you should sit down and start praying. And we need to have conversations about prayer more, because he will give you the opportunity. And you have to want to stop first.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a big important part. And I think people, how can I say this? I think people take too much responsibility off themselves.
Right.
And,
right.
Yeah. Yeah. And right. they want to put it in somebody else's
mm-hmm.
hands. And I think the first thing I would say is we need to get you straight first, and you wanting to stop first. And then let's start talking about God, and let's start seeing what opportunities he will give you to get back on the right path. But I think first it starts with you. And, if you don't want to stop, it don't matter what's going to happen. You're not going to stop if you're not ready.
So you're saying that God, though he's all powerful, there's not much he can do if you're not willing to receive.
Yeah, exactly.
Help.
Exactly.
Awesome. And no. I just want to reiterate once again, you can give a phone call in. You're talking to an awesome testimony from an awesome, awesome young man. Chris Danis, 609-807-2492. This is the ER, and we have our walk-in caller.
If you guys could repeat the question, it's a two-part question. I want to know, you've been out of the drug culture for 8 years. How, what do you think about, number one, the Narcan, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Narcan,
yeah.
And the mobile Narcan trucks, and being able, you know, parents being able to purchase it, and also the drug safe houses. What do you think of that?
Okay, I want to repeat the question, because I don't think they can hear on air. She asked Chris, what is his opinion on Narcan and the
number one,
the trucks, you know, the emergency vehicles that they're using to get to those who have overdosed, and the safe houses out in Philadelphia, which is not too far from us.
Mm-hmm.
They're talking about discussing having these safe houses where a person can go and shoot up in heroin with heroin. Legally,
mm-hmm.
I don't know how you can shoot an illegal drug legally, but you can shoot it up in a place where, you know, you're not going to get arrested. They'll give you clean needles.
Yes,
they'll give you
yes.
a clean environment. And so she's asking about his opinions on those things.
Well, right away, I want to hit the second question first, if that's all right. I think that's totally unacceptable, because right away you're just enabling somebody and
right.
taking
exactly.
it's okay
right.
to do it.
Right.
Whether you're doing it in a safe place or not. You shouldn't enable somebody, and that will prolong, you know, that will prolong them being on them drugs, especially
mm-hmm.
when something is there saying, hey, come on in, you can do that here safely. No, that needs to stop. The Narcan trucks, I hope that continues. That should continue until, well, indefinitely, because, you know, I've known a lot of people who sitting on a park bench, you know, putting a needle in the arm, and they're done, you know, they're done within minutes, and... If there was a Narcan truck riding around and a friend could run to it up the street real fast instead of their closest hospital, which could be, what, 10 miles up the road?
Right.
I think that that's a very important resource to have in hand. But those safe houses, I wasn't even aware that they were trying to do that. I think that's completely unacceptable. That won't do anything to help anything.
No, it won't.
No. And if somebody wants to get high, they're going to get high. A safe house isn't going to change whether they get high or not, and it's not going to lessen the fatality rate because it's a safe, clean room either. You know, you share a needle with somebody just because you're in a cleaner house, a safe space, that means nothing at all.
Right.
So I really don't see what the purpose of those things would be in the first place.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm actually it's funny. It's
yeah.
nonsense, to tell you the truth. I'm kind of baffled that they would even come up with an idea like that, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, they claim that it has a certain amount of success out in Canada, you know, but then we were watching the news and they were saying that in Canada it was like, no, actually it hasn't had the
yeah.
success that you're talking about. But, you know, I guess they still want to push forward with it. Doesn't make any sense to me.
No, not at all.
You know?
No.
It just sounds like a clean, you know, crack house that we had down the corner in Camden. You know, that's all it really sounds like. They have safe houses already. You know, just not everybody knows about them.
In fact, in Denmark and Sweden, they have park areas for people to shoot up their drugs. And they're finding out now it doesn't make a difference because they're always getting new people. People aren't stopping. They're getting new people. So what do we do about the epidemic?
Right.
And the answer is just say no.
Well, part of the solution should be more education and training.
Oh, right, of course.
I mean, you don't hear too much on the media, well, let's educate and train people on reasons like he's saying not to do drugs.
Right. That's right. You don't hear that.
I think they need to make it easier to get help, to tell you the truth. Mm-hmm. Narcan trucks,
right,
you know, that's great, but I think they need to make it a little more accessible because right now it's pretty expensive to get help. A lot of places don't take insurance. I know them doctors don't take insurance. You have to pay out of pocket if you want to start getting help.
Right.
Most rehab centers, they don't, you know, they don't take insurance. And if they do, insurance only covers, you know, so much. And then places are very expensive. I think they need to make it a lot easier to get help because a lot of people, you know, they go to get help and they hit a roadblock. Oh, now I can't afford it. Or now I have to wait for my insurance to clear something next month. And what are they going to do while they're waiting for that? Mm-hmm. They're going to go find more stuff so they're not sitting in that room in pain.
Right.
And here's the one that I don't know if y'all are even ready for this one. We have some people who are trying to get help, which is ridiculous. But if they come in there clean, they can't get help.
What?
Oh, absolutely. Mm. So I had so many people say, listen, I got to go get a bag so I can get accepted in here.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Absolutely. Too many times, and especially in profession and what I do, my job, because ministry is my life. But where I work at, you know, that's what I do. You know, I try to connect people to services and link them up to, you know, rehabs and different things. And you're so right, Chris. It is so hard. I had somebody give me a call one night, and an aunt trying to get one of her aunt trying to get her nephew service. Do you know it took like 6 weeks to get him service? He had no insurance. So now if you're in, I can't name the county, you got to go through the Board of Social Services. Because if another county is going to take him, you know what I mean, that county has to offer this county some money and give them the okay.
What?
Yeah. Oh man, it's a nightmare.
That's too long of
a
process.
A nightmare.
Yeah. 6 weeks, that's too long of a time for anybody that's doing drugs. You know, it only takes one day to stick the wrong needle in your arm or, you know, get the wrong stuff. And if somebody's crying for help, they should be able to get help right away.
That's right.
That's right.
And again, just like what you were saying and what Sister Schaefer was saying, preventive. Listen. Let's go to if we can do everything else as far as medical, we're talking about doing preventive measures first. Mm-hmm. Then let the education part be a preventive measure, especially with the drug and the alcohol, with our youth, with men and women who have been through it, who can talk about it. Now I'm not mad about you're going to get your education and you haven't been there because you have something to share as well. When you get your, you know, you get your degree and you can teach and talk about drug and alcohol, that's fine. But, you know, I want you to send me someone that can give it to me. Like, yo, I've been there, done that. This is my experience. Right. And this is what you're going to go through. Not everybody's going to take it, but you're going to open up an eye.
Right.
You'll save somebody.
Yes.
Right. You'll prevent someone from picking up that first.
And right. And maybe that's the role the church can play. Because society, these organizations don't want that to happen.
That's right.
Because they're losing money. So maybe the church can take the lead on that. And I believe if the churches start taking the lead on that, we will have a decrease in people getting hooked on drugs.
Well, you know, I'm going to nominate First Baptist Church of Robbinsville. We go in there and start educating. See, here's the thing. You don't have to have no license because, you know, the state got the – I ain't saying about New Jersey. I love New Jersey. But all states, they want their money. So in order for you to get a license, you got to have this requirement. You got to have that requirement.
Right.
Oh, yeah, in order for you to do – but to educate, I don't need my CD – you know, I don't need any of those licenses. I can educate.
Right.
So we can do a training and drug alcohol educational awareness programs all over the place.
And I think that's where you can start educating people where God comes in and where the power of prayer comes in.
Come on, like, Chris.
if you do this, if you start praying, if you start reading your Bible, he will give you the opportunity to move forward and get on the right path, mm-hmm. whether you want to or not. And I think, I know we can't change laws and, you know, we can't change the way rehabs accept people,
Absolutely.
But we can teach people about the power of prayer.
Absolutely.
And how he might not do it all for you, but he sure will give you the opportunity to do it for yourself.
That's
right.
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 And open up doors mm-hmm. that you didn't think could be open.
Yes.
And
right.
shut down doors, like
yes.
with yourself, Chris. Like all of a sudden, you just said, like, we made a decision. I prayed, and it stopped.
Yes.
I've heard so many testimonies like that. I also hold testimonies that, you know, it took a process.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
mm-hmm.
here it is. You're still in your process. Your process was he turned it around.
Yes.
You
yes.
know, that's what he meant.
Mm-hmm. And you know, people
wow.
want to know, like, you know, they're saying, I'm pretty sure somebody's listening and they're thinking, okay, there's a lot of talk about doing this educating on drugs and getting your license in the state, but they're like, you know, where is ministry? How come nobody's talking
exactly.
about ministry? This is ministry.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
This is ministry. The Bible teaches that we are to go out there and help those. He said, you know, when I was sick, when I was hungry and thirsty, did you go out there and help me?
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And if you did that to my brothers, at least to my brothers, you did that to help me. Well, these people that are hooked on drugs, they need help.
That's right.
You know what I mean? And so it's not about just standing in the church pulpit and preaching all the time. That is a part of ministry, yes. But it's a matter of going out and helping in the name of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And showing that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and you can get free
yes.
from what you're hooked on.
Yes.
The Bible says that where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can be free. You can be delivered from that. You know, when a child is delivered from its mother, he's separated from his mother. So you can actually be separated from that thing you thought was a part of your life forever.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Through Jesus Christ. So
That's
this
right.
is ministry.
Amen.
You know, I mean, we're not just all sitting here just, you know, just preaching and reading scripture. And I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with that. But to have secular talk like this is not outside of God's will.
Come on now.
If
help
we're talking
somebody.
About helping people.
That's right.
Right.
You know, we're talking about helping people not just get off drugs, but helping them also into the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
So this is awesome, you know, and I'm thankful that we have Chris on here, and I love guests like this that, you know, that's going to give us the real about what life is all about. You know, I mean, I don't want no one to sugarcoat it, because, you know, these drugs out there, that's why they got these Narcan trucks. Because the drugs they got out there today, they're so deadly.
Powerful,
and they move
yes.
so quick on people that
That's right.
people are taking one or two hits and they're gone.
Mm-hmm. I've had too many calls to the hospital to pray over a child who's now brain dead because of it.
Yeah.
You know, it's so devastating that I'm angry about what's going on. And this is what's needed. And I
yes.
thank God for the ER, Empowerment Christian Talk Radio. I thank God for us, you know, thank you, Chris, for being here and sharing. And we need the real. And let me help, you know, for those who want to talk about the Bible, let me help you out with what he said. He said this. It says in James, draw near to me.
That's right.
And I'll draw near to you.
Right, right.
What he's saying is, yo, listen, you got to make the move.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to listen. I need you to do all that you can do, and then I'm going to do that which you can't do.
Right.
But if you got two legs, get your behind up. Get on over there and move to that rehab. Get your butt up. Get on your knees and pray. This is what Chris is talking about today.
Mm-hmm. And once you hear the answer, move.
Move.
Yes.
Don't just stay down on your knees and keep praying and thinking that God's going to be like a genie in a bottle where you just give him a couple of little acknowledgments and
right.
he just show up and snap his finger. But you see that Chris said that when he prayed and he believed,
Come
he
on.
Said almost instantaneously God delivered him.
That's right.
But it took his obedience and his willingness to submit to God.
Right.
To the lordship
yes.
of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes, yes.
It took that
mm-hmm.
in order for God to move in his life. Now,
yes.
that doesn't mean that God is limited to mankind's power. No. But God's not going to override your will.
Mm-hmm.
No.
You know what I mean? So if you sit there and say, oh, you know, I want to believe in God, but I'm telling you, I really don't want to get off drugs.
You ain't getting off of
it. It's something that's, you know, exactly.
You're
exactly.
not getting off of it.
You know, now you could be sitting there fiending, but saying, I don't want this. Lord, I want to be free. He'll
yeah.
he'll work on that. He'll work on that. You know what I mean? But you can't say I need it both ways. So, you know, that also leads into the discussion of, You know, this thing of people just saying, well, just be who you are and God just accepts you who you are. You know, we're leading too many people to the pit of hell with that one. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You God will, like Pastor, you preached this morning, God will meet you where you are.
Yes.
But he's expecting change.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to make you a new being, a new creation. Right. You know what I mean? And that's what we got to teach people. Yes, God will accept everybody, but he wants to change you. You know, not leave you stranded where you are.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Everyone keeps mentioning the word teach and educate. And another thing that's key is we need to teach and educate people what the scriptures say about drugs. Because
right.
There's this assumption that it's not in the Bible, but it is.
No, yes, it is.
It is yes. Pharmaceutical is talked about yep. in the scriptures. It's a type of witchcraft. Like
that's right.
Designed to alter who you are.
Ooh-wee.
So that you can't operate
they need to hear that.
The way that God has told you to operate.
She needs
so
a mic.
We need to educate people on what the scriptures actually say, you know, say about drugs and pharmaceutical and what it is and how it affects you in the spirit man.
Rev, did you retain all that? Could you report
ultimately
that?
What she is saying that yes, we do need to be talking about education, but we need to be educating the people on what the Word of God has to say about
that's
drugs.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Come on.
You know, people seem to think, oh, the Bible don't talk about drugs.
But
the Bible does
it
talk
sure
about
does.
Drugs.
Yes, mm-hmm. It does.
The Bible speaks about pharmaceutical, like she brought up.
That's right.
Which is where we get pharmaceuticals.
That's right.
You know, we need to talk about the fact that, like she said, that's witchcraft.
Witchcraft. Come on.
You know,
help
witchcraft
somebody.
Is not just, you know, doing some hocus pocus stuff in some dark room.
Yeah, or you think a broomstick. Go ahead.
Exactly. Witchcraft is the altering of something through outside means.
That's right.
You
right.
know what I mean? And that's what drugs is doing to
that's
people.
Right.
And we need to be educated in those things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we need to educate people in those areas. That's why people like Brother Chris here is so vital to the kingdom of God, because someone that knows the experiences, but someone that also knows how God can move. And
mm-hmm.
how the Word of God addresses, you know, somebody
right.
that's been in the battle, that's the best person to lead people out of the battle.
Come mm-hmm. on now, keep sharing.
That's you know, right,
so
that's
I,
right.
You know, that's pretty much what she was saying. So the whole thing, what we're talking about here is vital. It's important. You know, it's not about dressing and looking the role of the church person. It's about actually getting involved all the way. All the way in what, you know, what you've been called to do. You know, I believe that God calls people to different areas, and
yes.
sometimes he allows you to go through different things to get into that call.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we do need to educate as the church. We do need to take our opportunity to study the Word, to show ourselves approved unto God, and become workmen that know how to rightly divide the Word as it comes to the different things, especially drugs.
Amen, amen. And we're going to go right back to one more piece. It is in the Word.
Right.
And that's the reason why we get, it says, be sober. Amen. And be vigilant.
Thank you.
You know, it's said so many times in the Word of God about being sober. That means, listen, and everybody said, well, you know, they was talking about wine. They was talking about, at that time, that was the mind-altering, mood-altering substance during the time. You know, be sober. Means, listen, be of sound mind. And everything else that take you off of the sound mind, that's what leads you away
right.
from Christ.
That's right. That's
for
right.
living your life. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's in there. And witchcraft is where you broke it down, Rev, and Minister, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
now,
man.
Now, you know,
have people believing that if I lick this frog or if I eat this mushroom, I take this drink, that I can get closer to God.
That's
things.
No.
Because it's a psychedelic drug in it, and they believe that they're really getting closer to God. It's crazy out there. I don't understand.
Lies being told. And the sad thing is, I'm not even talking about the world that doesn't believe in God. I'm talking about Christians
mm-hmm.
who do stuff like, I can't get close enough. God gave us tools to get close to him. Study the Bible, pray, and you can get close to God.
That's right.
You don't need anything else. Just you and God. That's all you need. Just you. That's
you
all God wants.
People like that felt like they were getting closer to God through the drugs that
Not personally, no. I mean, I've known of people that had that mindset, which, I mean, we've all just heard, you know, the word is in the Bible, so I don't know where they would be hearing that, because all they have to do is open a book and see that is totally false.
All right. Well, Chris, I want to switch this. I want to switch gears real quick because, man, this is great, and you are really, you know, you inspire me. You know, you're very inspirational, and I thank God for, you know, your just being open. But I know it's been 8 years now, and I know you've been in position, operating in your purpose. There's a lot of things that's opened up for you since being in position and cleaning up and, you know, following God. What has happened in those 8 years?
Well, a lot of doors have opened up, especially in at work. You know, I've got a few promotions. You know, a few people get my face out there. A few people know my name that I wouldn't think normally would know my name.
Come on!
I moved out of my little one bedroom apartment and we got a house.
Oh, you know, come on now! And, come on now!
And it happened in succession too. Like, it's crazy the way it happened. You know, the first promotion I got was right behind me buying my first house. And that was wonderful, you know, and, you know, I'm thanking God. And just, what, a month, 2 months after that, I start hearing of a possibility to go even further. And don't you know, like a year later, I'm moving up again. It was just like when I started praying and started believing more in God, how just overnight, pretty much, I get off the drugs. Later in life, the same thing happens, except, you know, not with the drugs, but success. And
wow.
Yeah, it's been a roller coaster, and I can only really say it's because I'm being blessed. I'm being blessed, and I'm hoping to pass that on to her very soon. I need to get her on board with that same mentality. But I know some people might think it sounds cliche, but God can do things for you overnight that you just normally wouldn't believe to be
That's
possible.
That's right.
Wow.
That's right.
That's right.
Let me share with you right now. You are blessing people right here on Facebook, on internet radio, and on YouTube. And this message, which you're giving, should be posted everywhere. And I hope people repost this because this is a message of hope and how to move forward in your life to get off of things. And listen, and how God moves when you're in position. So I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for this awesome testimony. We're not done yet. But right now you're listening to the ER, Empowerment Christian Talk Radio, where your guest is Mr. Chris Danis, an awesome young man of God. You can phone us at 609-807-2492. But right now we're going to take us a little station break, and you're about to hear from no other than Reverend Doris Warner.
Oh, thank you, Pastor. I've really enjoyed the education. I was not aware that I knew drugs did hurt the body, but to know that it's not just stop hurting when you stop using drugs, that it's a long term. And I think it would be a great idea if churches, pastors, if you're listening, have Chris come to your church and educate your people. And train your people what to look for, because I don't think people understand that it's not an easy thing. Because I've heard Christians say, oh, all they have to do is just stop. They can't just stop without God. Okay, that's it. Announcements. Bible study every Wednesday, 7 p.m. We're having our church picnic on September 14th from 12 to 6.
Yes.
Stop on by.
Come on down.
Join the fellowship.
Get
There'll be
fun.
Plenty of food, plenty of water and sodas to drink. Amen. And then we're also doing the book bag drive. So if you would like to buy some, donate supplies or donate money, you could just drop it off at the church. We'll be glad to take it and accept it. We're doing bags not only for our children, but also home front. So if anyone is interested in doing that, you are truly welcome. And for those of you listening, you've been touched by something that has been said here, you can contact the church. Remember, the ER, just like you go to the emergency room.
Uh-oh.
And they give you this pages of stuff that they diagnose you with, and they say, call your doctor within 1 week as a follow-up. So I invite you, I encourage you,
come on,
follow up with Dr. Jesus.
There she go.
And as Pastor Schaefer always says, and get a taste of that gospel that will heal you and give you peace and bring back your joy. And it's only because of God. You can come by First Baptist Church of Robbinsville. We're 22 Main Street. We're between Route 130 and 206. Or go to your local church. We will love you to death if you stop by Robbinsville. You will get your fill of love and encouragement to help you heal and be the one that God has called and to be on this earth. I'll turn it back to Pastor Schaefer.
All right. I want to thank Reverend Warner, who brought up Dr. Jesus. Amen. I have been encouraged, and it is definitely an encouraging word that was shared. And she said something real good. Boy, Brother Chris, your testimony and your help would be so great if people would just invite you and share. I know I'm going to invite you out. And we have some things that we call the BOE, Brotherhood of Emmanuel. We meet every other Monday right there, of course, by the Dunkin' Donuts in West Hampton. Yeah, man, we got to meet you. Need that. We need them donuts and coffee. Mm-hmm. Or those, if you want your tea, you can have your tea. You know, they, if you want your latte, all that other stuff. If you want some water, but I got to have some donuts.
I'd be more than happy to come out. You know?
Yeah. We thank you. And I think, you know, it's very important. Mm-hmm. But with that being said, I'm going to turn this back over to Reverend Cleveland.
Amen. Amen. First of all, you mentioned that 8 years ago you a beautiful child came along. Would you like to happen to mention her name?
Yeah, my little girl Sonia sitting right over there.
Hey, Sonia. Hi, Sonia. She is so beautiful. Hi.
Amen. Amen.
Sitting next to Olivia. Hi, Olivia.
If anybody needs to get in touch with you to ask you about a speaking engagement or anything like that, how could they get in touch with you?
They could text my cell phone, 609-891-5750, or you can shoot me an email at chrisdanis171@verizon.net. So that's chrisdanis@verizon.net.
Amen. So yeah. I encourage, as Reverend Warner said, that, you know, all pastors, and if you don't know what to say about drugs, because not all pastors know everything
everything. That's right.
Call somebody in who does know.
That's right.
And
mm-hmm.
allow them to do the work for you.
Educate.
You know, Brother Chris, you know, he talked about a lot of different things, a lot of good, great information. You know, he helped us out a lot, you know, but he started out where a lot of people started out, and that's saying that I really, you know, I believed in God, I knew about God, but I really wasn't all into the God stuff,
mm-hmm.
you know, and he didn't talk about this great bolt of lightning that struck him, and all of a sudden he believed in God. He just said to himself, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore, and I don't want to be here no more. So he said he prayed, and he was like almost instantaneous.
Come on.
God worked on his behalf. That's you know, right. Pastor, like you brought up, James 4:8, where it says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Mm-hmm. You know, so that means that we, as we had heard before, you got to put some skin in the game sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Come
sometimes
on now.
You got to get out there.
Go ahead.
And you got to move on what God is telling you to move on.
That's
right. Right.
And then, like he said, it almost seems cliche, but God worked almost overnight in his life. And that's how God is. God is not some, he's not like everybody else. He's not going to ask you to go through the process of filling out applications and doing all these different things and
that's
before
right.
he works in your life.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to take the process to help you to learn about him.
That's
and
right.
To grow stronger in him.
That's
but
right.
in order to be blessed, you just got to submit and confess him as Lord and Savior. And
come
you've
on.
Opened up the door all the way to be blessed beyond your wildest dreams.
Yes.
You know, so I thank Chris. I thank him for his testimony. I thank him for his willingness to come and just be open, be candid with us. and tell us everything we need to know, and open our minds to the fact that, you know what, the world needs to know that God loves the drug user too.
Yes.
That's right.
He loves them.
Come on now.
He wants to help
them. That's right. That's right.
You know? So thank you, Chris.
Not a problem. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, we still got like 8 minutes, huh?
Do we?
I think so.
And Brother Chris, if you ever feel like you have something more to say, to add to your testimony,
share it.
You're more than welcome to come back on and talk some more about it, because I believe what you have to say is so very important for a time such as what we have right now.
So what I'm going to ask at this time, do you have any closing remarks? We got another question from the walk-in caller. Go ahead, Minister Selena.
I wanted to know that it's been 8 years since you've been delivered. Have you been able to reach back and help people that you used in your old life that, you know, were also on drugs or used drugs with you, and or what do they think of you now?
I wouldn't say not many people. I don't really have. Still talk to many people from my old life, but I have helped people that I have since met, and it's hard at times. I try and sit them down, you know, and the first thing I really do is I start picking out some scripture, and the one word that drugs are in the Bible, and I can't remember I always thought it was pharmaki, but you were saying it was. There it is. Yes. Showing them that these things are in the Bible.
Go ahead.
And pretty much giving them the same story I just, you know, gave here. And that, like, it can happen overnight.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I'm living proof. And there's many other people that have had the same thing happen to them that I know personally. And some it's not going to be overnight for everybody, you know. So if it doesn't happen overnight for you, you shouldn't get discouraged. You know?
Right.
You just keep going and going and going.
Right.
Keep working on it. As long as you want to keep working on it, and as long as you keep throwing in prayers up to God, it's going to happen.
Yes,
it will
is.
Happen.
Come on. That's right. Amen. That's right.
Amen. And it's necessary to reach out there and to get people. And just moving where God is telling you to move to. You know, you don't call the shots. Let God call the shots.
Yes.
For you. Let him send you to who he needs you to talk to. You know what I mean? It might be somebody from your past. It might not be. But just let God do all the work. And you'll wind up exactly where you're supposed to be doing what you're supposed to be doing. You know, so again, you know, I want to thank Chris. And this is what the ER is about. Opportunities for people to give their testimonies and to be upfront. That's what it means to give our testimony to, you know, how can I effectively tell somebody how the power of God unless I tell them the depths of sin, you know, the depths that sin that Satan has taken me in. How can I really effectively tell you, you know, how God has mightily worked in my life? And so this is what the ER is about. And we, you know, we thank all of the people that tune in every week. You know, hearing, you know, different people saying, yeah, I watch you guys. I listen to you guys. I watch. I didn't even know that many people was actually watching this on a consistent basis.
Amen.
You know, but I'm thankful that God has given us this opportunity to have people like Brother Chris on and to give testimonies, because people need to hear.
Yes.
There's a lot of people out there, you know, in the world that don't know God loves me.
Right.
And he's willing to meet me where I am to save me. You know, people think there's a lot of people out there that think they're still too dirty.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
You know,
help
there's
help
a lot
somebody.
Of people out there that think, nah, I got way too many sins in my life.
Help them. Mm-hmm. Help them.
I've done way too many bad things. God
nope.
don't want
don't
me.
Love me.
Nope.
You know, but the thing about it, like our pastor used to say, as long as you're sucking air in your lungs, you still got an opportunity.
You still have an opportunity.
You know, to be saved. And this is why we do what we do. You know, this is why we invite the people on that we invite on, because we want them to tell the world, you know, and this is going out. All over the world. We want them to tell the world, you know what I mean? This is what I've been through, because they need to hear it. You know, it's not all about, you know, this testimony today wasn't just about drugs. It was about getting free from any grasp that the devil has on you.
That's right.
Any grasp.
Any grasp
that's
that he
right.
has on you. You know, it don't have to be drugs. You know, some people think, well, I don't need all that because I ain't never did no drugs. But, you know, you might be hooked on pornography.
Help them. Come on.
You might be depressed.
Come on.
You know, you might be
yes, sir.
In an abusive relationship.
That's
yes,
right.
Yes, you know, yes,
it can be a number of things.
Mm-hmm.
The devil has many ways to hook hook you mm-hmm. and pull you back.
That's right.
And drag you down. He has many devices to use. So mm-hmm. it don't have to be something as bad as heroin or something like that. You know, it can be just something as simple as disobedience. Mm. You know, anger, rage. Rage is a sin.
Yes.
That's right.
The Bible says to be angry but sin not. You know what I mean? So it could be rage. You know, so whatever it is, you know, this is helping. And I believe that God is calling people from all areas to help those that need the help. And we as the church, you know, like Reverend Warner was saying, we got to open up and allow these people to, you know, come in and educate.
That's right.
And educate in whatever areas.
Again, Brother Chris, and we are opening up and we are definitely going to be inviting you over. And we definitely in every form that we can do. To make sure this word and the help that God's given you to give out, because that's what, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He's given it to you to give out. We'll make sure that you have a platform. And it's one thing that I was told a long time ago, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, God has given you a platform to open up a platform for others. So again, I want to thank you for coming on to the ER.
Appreciate it.
And you've been an awesome, awesome guest.
Thank you.
This has been the ER, Empowerment Christian Talk Radio. I'm your host, Ed Schaefer. I want to thank Sister Cheryl. I want to thank Reverend Warner and Reverend Cleveland and our Colin Walker, Reverend Minister Sister Selena
Yay.
Cleveland.
Yay.
Again, this has been the awesome radio yeah. program with our host and our brother and our help, Brother Chris Danis. Mm-hmm. Position, purpose, promise. God will see you through. Thank you. We'll see you
Amen.
Second week of September.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And 3 more months to Christmas.
There's an all.